like to thank the sponsors, Google, SUSE, MySQL, Oracle, C, Intel, and some other names on the banner here, including Microsoft. So our next speaker, okay, his name is Vishnu Patekar. And just a short introduction, he's going to introduce the Linux-Sunxi community. This is the community behind Linux kernel and U-boot contributions. He'll talk about current status on contributions and which silicon or chips are supported on the mainline. So Vishnu is an open source enthusiast, currently working for automotive company in Singapore. In his free time, he contributes to mainline U-boot and mainline Linux kernel. He has contributed to Linux mainline kernel and U-boot for Allwinner. That is a Chinese company, silicon on chips. Linux contributions are listed here in git.kernel.org. And also U-boot contributions at git.denx.de. Okay, so
Well, thank you for the introduction. So I'll be speaking about the Sunxi community, which is supporting adding support for Allwinner SOCs in mainline kernel and U-boot. And these are the topics we'll get to know about. We'll get to know about what Allwinner is, the Sunxi community, the current status of U-boot and kernel, and the roadmap for the same. And we'll get to know about a little bit some interesting products in the market. And if you wish to come contribute to this community, where should you start? The Allwinner is a Chinese semiconductor company which designs super cheap SOCs. They started in 2007 and their features mostly are like cheaper and powerful hardware, and the market they are targeting is tablets, smart homes, VRs, some set of boxes. They are not into smartphone market because there is already competitive market in there. So some bad things about Allwinner. Yes, the software quality. So they have really powerful hardware, but the software is buggy, and sometimes it's not really helpful. If you buy $30 tablet and it doesn't really work pretty much good way, then it's useless. That's the reason we have this community and a lot of active members putting this community. But the problem is Allwinner is not interested to work with community, and also they are not supporting them in case of some problems, maybe the documents. And also in number of instances they have violated GPL licenses. You can get to know about which GPL licenses they have violated. You'll find it on Sunxi wiki there. So, and the worst part is the documents. They don't release documents, and maybe till 1 year after they release the products in the market. So that's how we suffer, the community members suffer, because without documents we have to rely on their buggy code, which we really don't know whether it's correct or wrong.
Then why do you do it? I mean, it's the only thing that comes to mind. Why?
So
you're giving a bunch of reasons of why never to do it.
Yes, the reason we are doing it, it's super cheap, it's really powerful hardware.
Yep, but why do you do it?
So it's my hobby as a kernel contributor. I want to have super cheap hardware to run Linux on in the market, and anybody can have access for it.
Okay.
Yeah. So for a number of instances like the DDR3, but the positive side we can say is nowadays Allwinner is responding to our queries, and they are sending us some of the documents, and sometimes they also send the code which they have already violated the GPL licenses, but they clean up and send it to us for adding support to it. So then that's a positive thing. Maybe they'll contribute to community soon. So as they are also a member of Linaro group, so I think they are willing to, but they might be running out of resources. So let's talk about the SOCs. There are more than 20 SOCs in the market right now. So the A10 is the first SOC they made in 2012. They made from 2010 to 2012. They made some F series SOCs, but these are kind of already obsolete now, and we are not interested in that. So A10 is Cortex A8 single core SOC. We'll get a Mali GPU, SATA, HDMI, Ethernet as well, and there are standard interface like SPI, I2C, IPS. Those are present on all these SOCs.
Do they have any other interesting hardware units? So I assume they must have H.264 or 265, some sort of video.
Yeah, video also they have.
Do they have like JPEG, like for camera stuff, etc.,
yes,
etc.? Okay. So encoder, decoder?
Yeah.
Is that supported in kernel?
No. So that's the reason. The camera support is in progress right now. So there are a lot of people working on that. You'll get to know about the current status, which interface really supported in right now is in progress and which are not yet done. So there are around a lot of people contributing to this community. I'm one of those. Mm-hmm. So the next one they did is A30. They sometimes just rename it as a marketing name for R8 or A13. So it's without SATA, the A10, but without SATA, so it's a cheaper version of A10. The A20 is a dual core Cortex A7 processor. It again has Mali GPU, and they put the SATA back to this SoC. And the A23 and A33 is similar to A10, but without SATA. A31 is quad core with Power VR GPU.
Just a sec, the A23 has no display out, so what does it do? Any LVDS or something?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, all the interfaces are not listed here because they are huge. So, yeah, but this is just some of the interface which I was interested in. And so, A31 is with the Power VR, and it has Ethernet and HDMI as well. So A33 is similar to A23, but with quad core Cortex A7. The A80 is a big little architecture. That means it has Cortex A7 for low power requirements and Cortex A15 for high power requirements. So putting them together, it's they achieve both the things. So it's Cortex A7 quad core Cortex and Cortex A15 with the Power VR G6320 GPU. So A83 we can we call it sometimes H8 or R58. There are a couple of boards here with me. So it's a octa core Cortex A7 with Power VR GPU and Ethernet and HDMI also. The next one is A64. It's the first 64-bit Allwinner SoC. So it has Mali 400 MP2, so it's capable of even running 4K videos. And H2 and H3 is similar with Cortex A7 quad core with Mali MP2 GPU. Mm-hmm. H5 is again a recent 64-bit SoC with Mali 450 MP4 GPU. So these are some of the boards like which are cheap in their own range. So the cheap is cost around $9. So like if you see, you get a single core Cortex A8 for $9, quad core Cortex quad core 32-bit for $15, and quad core 64-bit for $29. The cheap and the Pine 64 were actually crowdfunding-based Kickstarter projects, and the cheap already has raised $2.5 million, and Pine 64 raised around $1.7 million. So these are really cheap hardware available in the market. The Nano Pi Neo is based on the Friendly ARM. As we know, Friendly ARM is it's known for the cheapest hardware. So you get a H3 with 512 or 1GB DDR3 and 8GB eMMC for $15. So a little bit about the Sunxi community. They started in 2012, and the name comes from the like they Allwinner has codenamed their SOCs as Sun 4i, 6i, 7i. So this X in Sunxi is comes from these numbers. So I think I got to know that Sun means some new things, new way of thinking in Chinese. That's what some of my friends told me. So it's become a very vibrant community with 1300 mailing list members and 150 active members on the IRC channel. So the main focus of this community is adding support for EPO and kernel for these SOCs. As there is nobody is interested into adding support for Android. Let's talk about the U-boot current status. So A10, A13 and A20 are supported mostly in the U-boot. Like in, if we go by stages like 2014, we only had support for A13 and A20. And that also eMMC and MMC for those SOCs. So from 2014 to 2015, we progressed a lot. We added support for 8.13, 8.23, and also somebody was working on the A80 as well. So the hypervisor support, that's PSCI, that's for the SMP support we have to add, and we can go shut down and suspend and resume mode. So 8.20, 8.31 and A33 has support for this PSCI. The video was supported with like HDMI LCD VGA targets with simple FV support there, and USB also is supported there. The SATA and Ethernet is also there. So for NAND, only SPL support was added, and till March from August 2015 to till March 2017, we have already added support for A83, H3, A64, and H5 as well. So A83 PSCI support is in progress now. The USB support for A83 is also in progress.
So this is support in U-boot itself,
yep.
Right?
Yes.
Why? What is U-boot actually doing with any of the display output? I've never seen it used.
So, just in case you want to see like the PXE boot, you can.
Yeah, but I've never seen it used. That means U-boot will have to have at least a font embedded. We'll have to have font rendering embedded, etc., right?
Yes.
It does have all of that.
Yes.
Okay, right. I've never seen it used.
Yeah, just a text based. You can see. Output there.
Okay. I've always seen you boot headless, just over serial. Never seen it actually happen as well.
Yeah. So the reason we had support for this one is there are tablets which do not have the UART console. We don't know which pins they are using. So the community members using the microSD breakout board to get the UART out to the computer console. Otherwise, you can have the serial, the display, and it will display the serial console on the LCD. So it helps to put the image and all. So adding support for U-boot comes in some stages. Like so, the ARM-based SOCs mostly work in this way. Like the boot ROM looks for some signature or some binary image in a microSD or NAND or NOR, and then from there they copy that small part, maybe 32 KB of the code, and put it into the internal RAM, and from there they initialize the DDR3. Once DDR3 is initialized, we can boot the U-boot and then copy the kernel over.
That's the internalized RAM, right?
Yes.
How much do they have?
It depends on the SOC. Some SOCs are with 16 KB, some 13, 64, some are with 128, the recent ones.
Okay.
Yeah. So, when we do not have any code for the DDR3 controller, as we do not have the documents for them, so initially the community members has reverse engineered the boot 0 binary and got DDR3 working and got the configuration for the DDR3. So initially what we do is the boot 0 binary we use to get the DDR3 initialized. Once we have those parameters, we add support for PMIC, and then PMIC will switch on the power DDR3 and initialize it. So after that is done, DDR3 is working, we can add more support for Ethernet and USB and video for both SOCs and U-boot. So this is the current work in progress, like A83 USB PCI that I already talked about. Somebody is working on the R40 SOC as well. And the Allwinner SPI driver is also in progress. So in this month we will release the U-boot that's with A64 SPL support, H5 support, and the Nano. These two boards are also supported there. Nano Pi DOA and Orange Pi PC2. So let's talk about the upstream kernel status. It started in 2012, so 2012 to August 2015, we have support for all of these, like the SMP support for A20, A31, A23, A33 as well. So
if you go like, we added support for A20, SATA in A10 and A20. USB support is almost available all the SOCs. I2C is also available there. The SPI support is available except A23, A33 and A80. So Ethernet support was there for these three SOCs only. MMC is available for all these SOCs. The DMA support is only available for A33, A23 and A80. The simple FB support that kernel relies on the display initialized by U-boot, and we can get a simple display and console outputs there. So CPU frequency we can have, like we have it for A10, A13 and A20, A33 as well. The crypto engine is also supported for these four SOCs, and the OSB OTG was available except A80. So from August 2015 to March 2017, we added this support. So you can see that the DMA support for 810, 813 and 820 is also added. The CPU frequency for A33 is in progress. The new SOCs we added, like A64, H3, H5 and V3R. V3R is a new SOC with very cheap cost, similar to A13. It's a single core, so that we don't have the SMP there. So SMP support for A80 and A83 is also in progress. The SPI is available in all the SOCs except it's in progress. For A64, the USB host is also supported across all the SOCs. The A83 and A64 is in progress. So SATA is not available except A10 and A20 because there is no set of hardware there. So the Ethernet support for A80, A83, 64, all these SOCs in progress. So it's already working, but we are waiting for get it accepted in the U-boot. Maybe in this release or next release it will get accepted. The MMC support is almost there for all the SOCs except A83. We have it's working stage, but we need to verify it more so that it's complete.
So DMA support for A83 is not available. The H5 and H3 is already added, and others the support is in progress. The simple IP support for these SOC, that the newer SOCs we need to add. The crypto engine support is also in progress. The USB OTG it's available for H3 and H5, and A83, A64, and A80 is in progress. So these are the new drivers. Like now, kernel is moving towards the new display driver structure. They are not using the frame buffer anymore. So this DRM, Direct Rendering Manager, display drivers is added for A10, A13, A20 is in progress. So other display driver are not available. So maybe some of you could start working on this. And the camera support for A10, A13 and A20 is available. For A83 is already there. A64, H3 and H5 is also in progress. So the RSB, the I2C is most available for all the SOCs except A80 and A83. So the RSB is a reduced serial bus. It's similar to serial bus developed by Allwinner. So it's similar to I2C, but it can go up to 20 megahertz frequency. So Watchdog is available across all the SOCs. Except H5, and A64 is in progress. Pin controller driver is available for all the SOCs in kernel. So the modern, now Sunxi SOCs we switched to modern clock driver, and for A13 and A23 and A80 is already available for, it's in progress for A10, A13 and A83. A64 and AV3 are still not yet available. So this is just a summary of what we talked about in the last slide. So adding support for newer SOCs, what we do is in initial stage we just get UART working so that we can debug. And the basic device tree file to initialize these UART pins, and so that we can add more support for clock and all. So once UART is working, till now we are using the UART initialized by U-boot. So we need a clock and pin control driver to be working here. So once a clock and pin control driver is working, we can add start adding support for newer drivers like I2C, SPI, DMA, all these things, including displays. So let's have a look at some of the interesting stuff. This is a Pine book. This is again Pine. It's based on the Pine 64. It's Cortex A64 bit laptop, and it's. The Pine 64 guy is, he said he is one of the founding member of Apple, and he wants to make this one as MacBook. So look and feel is similar to MacBook, as they claim. And I think one day I could compile the kernel and send patches from this laptop, cheaper laptop. Or hopefully it doesn't disappoint. So this is all-in-one VR. Like in market, the VRs we have is based on some of the VRs are based on mobile. We keep our mobile, but personally I don't like mobile using as a VR, because once we get a call and we are playing some games, then we disappoint sometimes. But if we get this kind of VR for $150, then it's interesting. So this is a V3 based 360 degree camera. And we already have support for V3 added in the latest kernel, so somebody can just add support for this device as well. It will be a little easier, but the camera working, somebody has to work on that as well. So if you're willing to contribute to this community or adding support for Allwinner, you can start here. Like you can join the mailing list.
IRC channel, and if you have some questions, you can ask on the IRC. Find some of the interesting codes. You can once you got a code, start picking up the task from this left to be done list, and you can also refer to the previous slides, which support is not added. And I would say it's really easy to add support. It's not that hard. The people in the community are very supportive. I started in 2014. I just mailed the maintainer of this Allwinner SOC, that's Maxim Ripper. I sent him a mail like, I want to contribute to Vishnu Patekar. So he gave a guideline, and it's really, the people are really encouraging and adding, helping us to, like, literally from where should we start and what to do if you are stuck somewhere. And once you have something like bug fixes or patches ready, you can look for these tutorials there. It's the general tutorials how to contribute to Linux kernel community. And once you get stuck somewhere, then you can just ask it the questions to IRC. The IRC is fastest way to get the answers to your questions. I would say just a request, like don't keep asking again and again, because people are working in different time zones and might be sleeping when you ask questions. So these are some of the past SUNXI talks given by members. Questions, please. No questions.
Do you actually have hope of getting all of the documentation? So you're not going to get documentation for the Mali. Go poke around for that. But for the rest?
Yeah, for the rest, till A83, we have already got the documentation.
All of it, or just some of it?
No, all of it.
Really?
Yeah, except the DDRP controller documentation is
okay. Right.
Yeah,
that's missing. But that means you have documentation on all the iPad, all of the
resources than A83, yes.
Yeah, but also all the hardware units, they're just drivers aren't necessarily written for. So from what I asked, if the camera work or the JPEG compressor decompressor works.
Yeah,
no,
I mean the video.
It, but you've got the documentation.
Yes.
To be able to write it.
Yes. There are some available, but like Video Engine is for not available.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Not all the documentation.
Yes. That's correct. So, but positive side that they are responding to queries. If somebody asks them about Video Engine, they may also give us.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you have some questions, you can just write to me, and thank you.
Okay, round of applause. So this